artistry is so much more than just bending your body a little bit extra or having a little bit more dramatic porter bra. Hey, dancer friends, it's Kirsten, and welcome to my living room, also known as the Twin Talks Ballet headquarters. I am so thrilled to be bringing you today another technique tip video, but this time focusing, of course, on artistry, as you've seen in the title. Today, I'm going to be delivering to you three powerful tips on how to enhance or improve your artistry. I wanted to make this video because I believe I have some pretty profound and unique ideas on this that I've developed over years and years and years of training, and also just getting to learn from other artists who are obviously much better and more mature than me. I've learned that artistry is so much more than just bending your body a little bit extra or having a little bit more dramatic porter bra. It also is an opportunity to share your artistic voice and to really share feelings and meaning, emotion really, with your art that really says something about who you are. And I believe that with good artistry comes great confidence, because with good, authentic artistry, you're showing who you are as a person, which is incredibly unique. No two people are alike. And I think as dancers, we so often get stuck in struggling with comparing ourselves to other dancers because we are putting so much of an emphasis and a value on technical prowess in order to kind of rank ourselves and our value and assess what our future will be in the ballet world, without giving proper attention and respect to how important and honestly transformative good artistry is. So today I'm going to bring to you three tips that go beyond just bend more to help you enhance your artistry as a dancer. Okay guys, so the first tip I want to share with you, and I promise I will demonstrate some, that's why I have my little Marley patch out here. The first tip I want to share with you is that good artistry isn't just, like I said, about bending more. It's about treating each movement as a real gesture with meaning. So here's how I like to describe this to my students and clients that I work with in the Mindset Plus Movement Technique Accelerator Program, which, by the way, if you're interested, is a program I've created that combines technical coaching at a high level, also with mindset coaching, to help you overcome the mental blocks that are inhibiting you physically and to also adjust to certain aspects of your technique which have been causing the biggest insecurities and frustrations for you, so that you can really see a dramatic improvement in your confidence as a dancer and your dancing. So if you're interested in that program, link is in the description below. I'd love to have you apply. But what I tell my clients and my students when I teach group classes is that ballet and dancing in general is really like body language taken to the extreme for the sake of art. So if you see that when people are communicating, they're communicating so much with their physicality, even if it's not their hands, it's their face, it's their posture, it's their energy about them, which is all coming from their body. Research has shown that 55 and maybe even more percent of communication is transmitted through body language when communicating in person. Of course, over the phone, most of it is actually tonality, not the words that you're saying. And I think this fact is so important to know, because when you are dancing, you are communicating pretty much 100% through your body language. So if you are mindful that, for example, when you do a gesture like first position and then you open up this way, it's not just something you do because you were told to do. When you think of actually saying something with your body language, if you were just out in the wild, you know, living your normal life, and you were like, hey, you know, or you can imagine the elegant people in the olden days who would invite guests into their big dinner parties or whatever, they welcomed their guests into their home, and I imagine they would do things like this. Maybe now it's not so much of a surprise why we have these gestures, since the origin of ballet was in Europe during those times. If you imagine that this gesture is saying something, what do you think it would be saying? In my opinion, I do think that this is a, typically with this palm up kind of gesture, that's a gesture of invitation. It's a connection and saying, you are welcome here, or you're welcome. You know, it's acknowledging the person you're communicating with. And so instead of just treating this as my teacher said, go to first and then second position with your arm, and then maybe you remember to take your head with the arm, connect not only that understanding of, you know, the palm up and a lifted elbow, that communicates confidence. See how when my sternum lifts, this is the body language of what? Confidence, ease. Not arrogance and stiffness, but just confidence and ease. Compared to if we just isolated and took all the meaning out of this gesture and just made it about take your arm to first, take it to second. There's really no feeling that's transmitted behind that. And what is appreciating good dancing other than just transmitting feelings from the dancer to the viewer? So if on the inside, you're understanding as an artist now, not just a technician, not just a dancer, but as an artist, you're understanding that this means something. It really matters. And you pair that arm gesture with an appropriately corresponding facial expression and expression in your eyes. All of a sudden, this simple arm isn't just about the arm. It's about what I'm communicating and how I'm making the people who are watching me feel. You can have different opinions. Just find some meaning behind your gestures. When I connect with what I'm showing and what I'm saying with my body language, I could do something even like an arabesque. And it reminds me that when I really extend my line and my eyes are engaged and I'm looking into infinity, to me, this is the body language of expansion, happiness, almost that idea that with this kind of gaze, it communicates that our world is so big, anything is possible. And I know I'm extrapolating so much, it might seem like, you really think that, Kirsten? Honestly, I don't think it all the time as I dance. But after years and years and years of thinking about why I do what I do and how I want to do it as an artist, not just as someone who's doing what they're told, I feel these things as I'm dancing. I don't have to cognitively think, invite people with your dancing. I'm feeling it. So I want to invite you to see that every gesture in ballet is saying something and really choose what you want to say with your gestures and feel what you're trying to say. So as you do these gestures, so that you're really better connecting with your audience and you're creating an experience for yourself and others. For my second point, I want to talk about what your role is in also helping the audience better appreciate the other art form that is often intertwined with ballet, which is music. I find it so incredible that in a ballet performance, pretty much all the time, unless you're doing a silent ballet, in which case the dancers are often creating a sense of music with their breath or the sound of their feet sliding on the floor. They have an internal sense of rhythm. But my point is that so often in pretty much every ballet performance, we're not just watching a ballet. We're also appreciating another art form, though it's not taking center stage, which is music. It's so amazing how in ballet these two art forms collide. And so my second point is to say that good artistry, I believe, is also coming from an understanding and a practice of this understanding that as a dancer, it is partially your role and your opportunity to help the audience better appreciate and become aware of what there is to appreciate in the music that you're dancing to. So instead of just making musicality about knowing the counts so that you are doing your pique arabesque at the same time that everyone else is doing their pique arabesque, or you know, you're just on the music, you're being musical, instead of just thinking of it in such a utilitarian kind of way, I like to think of musicality and artistry combining as this intention to actually draw the audience's attention to the intricacies of the music. So you're leading not only to a better appreciation of dance, but also of music. And this is combining with that lesson I like to share that through where you are putting your focus, through your eyes and your energy and where you're projecting your energy and your gaze, you are also taking the audience's attention with you. So you are directing where their eyes go, as long as you're doing it on purpose. You know, you can kind of just have this blank stare out into the audience, and then you're really not directing their gaze anywhere. They might get bored, and they might not feel very connected to you, the audience that is. And so their eyes might kind of just wander anywhere. If you are doing what I'm about to share, you can not only direct the audience's attention to aspects of your dancing, but also to the music. So let me share with you an example. So unfortunately, I won't be able to use an actual piece of music just for copyright infringement reasons, but I can use my voice for you to kind of help you imagine that there's music playing. So let me show you what I meant in that point. Okay, so I'm just going to show you a very simple tombe pas de bourrée. Now, if a dancer is primarily focused on technical excellence and following through with implementing technical corrections, a dancer might just focus on, okay, we're gonna turn out this leg, we're gonna show the heel, we're gonna open our chest, sorry. You know, we're so focused on the form. But what about the quality? What about directing the audience's attention? I know I'm like hunching over and it's weird. I'm gonna watch this back later and be like, girlfriend, just stand up straight. If we're to actually direct the audience's attention, both to specific aspects of our movement and the music, on one hand, we can be all about the technique. We can try to just make a beautiful tombe pas de bourrée and just focus so much on the footwork and whatever, you know. I was still doing it with quality there. But notice this. Okay, so we can just be like, and one, and two, and three, and four, you know. We can just make it so blah, 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 follow the counts like that. Or if you're being artistic, you're using your awareness of the intricacies of the music and also how many options you have for how you can execute a certain step within the framework of technical excellence. You might do something more like this. If the music goes and bum, 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 you might choose to slide your foot along the floor to show that if the music is in a three, it's bum, one, and a two, and three, and a four. I'm not only accentuating the bum, ba, 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 the extension of that note, that first note, but I'm also directing the audience's gaze by either choosing to draw the attention to my foot by looking here, or also correct is looking out this way. So I draw the attention to my face and my upper body, which is the bum. Da, 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 da. Those are just some examples on how you can direct the audience's eye towards specific aspects of your dancing and also the music. Okay, friends, my third and final tip is to remember that in ballet, you are sharing a feeling, a story. You're expressing something. And so often, even if there's a story or not, which in many neoclassical works today, there's not an actual story. It's more you're sharing a concept, you're sharing a feeling. There's not much meaning, and the choreographer wants the audience to just draw out of the experience what they will. But I believe no matter what, at its core, in a performance, in a class, at any point, you are sharing a feeling. You're almost like a leader in cultivating a feeling inside of yourself, radiating that through your dancing, and therefore sharing that feeling with the person who's watching you. For example, in a story ballet, if a dancer is trying to act out a part, maybe it's Clara in the Nutcracker. The Nutcracker got broken and she's sad, you know? If she's not really feeling that on the inside, it's not going to come out very effectively in her body language, and the audience is just going to be like, as I've probably thought so many times when watching the Nutcracker, is she sick? What's happening? You know, when Clara's like, do that thing, and I'm like, whoa, 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 sister, like no one cries like that, I don't think. Not a lot of people cry like that, I'll put it that way. So anyway, my point is, even when you're communicating a story, how authentic the story is and how it's transmitted really boils down to how authentic your feeling on the inside is to that story and how effectively you're sharing that feeling with the audience. So no matter story or not, classwork or on the stage, remember, in order to effectively move people with your art, to add value to other people with your artistry, I think good artistry comes from also cultivating a feeling in yourself as you dance, hopefully a good one, and letting that shine through your dancing so that the people who are watching you would be positively impacted in some way. So if you want to share joy in your dancing, you aren't going to do it with just opening your mouth and showing your teeth. It actually gets kind of scary when dancers fake smile and they get tired on stage. I mean, oh, all right, I've been guilty of this. I'm not trying to judge. It's like the, it doesn't communicate joy just because you're kind of artificially making a facial expression. Joy is felt when you are first feeling it on the inside. And that's also why I think mindset coaching is so helpful for ballet dancers, to help dancers really get to the root of their insecurities and their doubts and their fears and their limiting beliefs about themselves, so they can let that go and adopt a mindset of confidence and joy as they perform, so they can really be feeling that confidence, feeling that joy. And I promise you, it moves people when you're really feeling that on the inside, no matter how good or bad your technique is. It makes people feel something. And honestly, that's just what people want out of watching a performance like this. So the tip is, feel on the inside what you want others to feel through your art as you are dancing, in order to effectively create that experience for the both of you. All right, dancers, I hope you really, really enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up and let me know what you think in the comments. I'd love to hear specifically which point you're most excited to start putting into practice in your ballet classes. And again, I want to remind you about my program, MMTA for short, the Mindset Plus Movement Technique Accelerator. If you are a pre-professional dancer interested in really giving your training a boost and also your confidence a boost, whether you want to increase your ability to turn out or to increase your confidence in your extensions and in your adagio, this is really a perfect program for you if your primary insecurities are about your technique. I would be so happy to address those insecurities with you, both by helping you to adapt your technique and to make key shifts that can be implemented somewhat quickly in order to make the biggest difference in your technique and to help your dancing feel good in your body, and also to give you the mindset work in order to feel confident and to really dance without limits. So if that's something you're interested in, again, check the link in the bio and apply for my program. I'd be so excited to work with you. All right, dancers, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next week. Bye.